I'm Joseph Tainter. I'm a professor of sustainability at Utah State University. I work on sustainability of societies over long periods of time, focusing on solving problems, growing in complexity, energy costs, and innovation.
Great. So thanks very much, Professor Tainter, for coming in.
It's
and
a pleasure.
Talking. We mentioned, this is a this is one of our interviews for the disruption class that we're teaching across the entire UC system. And so what we wanted to do was to talk with you about about your work and about where you see the world going, and opportunities for human civilizations to address sustainability issues. So on that topic, would you you said a few words about your research. Could you summarize what work you generally do?
Well, early in my career, I was an archaeologist, and archaeology was my first love. I wanted to get out in the dirt and find ancient civilizations and excavate interesting things. And as a consequence of that, in the 1980s, I did a study of why ancient civilizations would occasionally collapse, the Roman Empire, the Maya, and several others. What I learned during that study was that the things that caused ancient civilizations to collapse, that made them vulnerable to collapse, also applied to us, that I was learning lessons that were applicable to our situation today and to the future. One of the things I learned is that this is the factors that make a society sustainable or vulnerable to collapse develop over very long periods of time. These are periods well beyond the experience of an individual's lifetime. I'm talking periods of decades, generations, or even centuries. So to understand sustainability, it's necessary to look at long time intervals, or unsustainability, or a threat of collapse. It's necessary to understand these over long periods of time. So sustainability has to be a historical science. It can't be based only on short-term observations or an understanding of, say, only the present day. Another thing I learned is that ancient societies tended to grow in complexity as they solved problems. The classic example of this is the Roman Empire, which experienced major challenges from barbarian invasions and wars in the eastern part of the empire and problems of civil wars in the 3rd century AD. And the Roman Empire nearly came to an end during this time. But it responded by increasing the size and complexity of the government and the army, and succeeded in reestablishing its borders and succeeding in surviving for another 200 years. But to accomplish this was very costly. It had to increase taxes on the peasants, people living on a subsistence income, and ultimately in the long run, the increase in taxation weakened the empire's finances and brought it down. So there are several lessons that emerged from this. One is that sustainability is a function of success at solving problems. Now, there's a tendency to think, particularly in common discourse, but even in academic discourse, there's a tendency to think that sustainability emerges simply as a passive consequence of consuming less. What I find is that's not the case. The sustainability is an active condition of solving problems, and solving problems often causes societies to grow more complex. We can see this happening in our society today. If you think of how are we responding to the problem of terrorism, how did we respond to the problems, the attacks of September 11, 2001? Well, we established new government agencies, the Department of Homeland Security, Transportation Security Administration, and we increased organization and controls over behaviors that are thought to be threatening. These are all increases in complexity, and they carry energy costs. Another example might be the development of hybrid automobiles. We have problems of pollution and a need to conserve fossil fuels. So we've gone from automobiles that have one means of propulsion to automobiles that have two. Again, it's an increase in complexity, and it carries an energy cost. So societies, I learned, solve problems by increasing in complexity, but this is always costly. There is always an energy cost to increasing in complexity. And ultimately, what happens in societies like the Roman Empire or the Maya or any of the ancient societies that I've looked at in detail is that late in their histories, the cost of being the society goes up and up and up, but the benefits of being that society don't increase. Basically, they increase costs to maintain the status quo. This has some important lessons for us today. If we think of the problems that we face in the future, things like restoring damaged ecosystems, funding retirement pensions for people of my generation, probably increasing healthcare costs, replacing our decaying infrastructure. All of these are costs that have to be undertaken, but they don't yield any new net well-being or any increase in our well-being. They're things that we have to do simply to maintain the status quo, simply to keep our lives from getting any worse. So complexity increases to solve problems, but at some point complexity yields diminishing returns. Mm. Costs grow higher and higher, and the benefits either don't grow as quickly or sometimes actually decline. So these are some of the lessons that I learned about how the collapses of ancient societies help us understand our situation today.
So are there ways to solve human problems by simplifying? Or is it uniformly adding complexity, or are there instances that you know of successfully addressing a problem by making things simpler?
In my historical research, I've come across only one case where a large complex society survived by simplifying. And this was the case of the Byzantine Empire, which was the successor of the Roman Empire in the Eastern Mediterranean. After the Arab invasions of the 7th century AD, they lost about half their land and half their resources and half their income. And as a result, they had to simplify. They got rid of their full-time army. Most of their cities were abandoned, and the economy came to focus on rural manors. Coinage almost disappears from the economy. The army came to consist of primarily a peasant militia for a couple of hundred years, and they survived this way. They reduced their costs, and they survived, and they recovered. In a couple of centuries, they were on the offensive again. So you could say, yes, they achieved a measure of sustainability or resilience by simplifying. So the good news is it can be done.
Okay.
The bad news is they didn't do it voluntarily. They did it because their backs were to the wall.
Yeah.
And this is the only case I know of.
Okay.
So I would say societies don't simplify voluntarily. They do it when they're forced to.
Okay. So looking at current industrialized society, where do you think we stand on this? I don't know if it's exactly a continuum from you know, so complex that we're going to collapse to so simple that everything's going to be okay. Where does current industrial society stand? Do you feel like are our backs up against the wall like the Byzantine Empire?
Well, I need to clarify, first of all, that complexity is not inherently good or bad.
Okay.
It's either useful and affordable or it's not.
Okay.
So we have the most complex societies that have ever existed, and we are solving many problems by having complex societies. We have programs of innovation, we have technologies, all of which help us to solve problems. The reason why we're able to afford them is because of fossil fuels. Basically, we run our societies on the bank account of ancient solar energy that's stored within the Earth. As the net energy that we get from fossil fuels declines, we face a great challenge in the future with, first of all, the availability of fossil fuels to fund our level of complexity and our way of life, and secondly, the net return that we get on exploiting fossil fuels. It takes energy to get energy. Mm-hmm. And in the United States in 1940, we were able to produce oil and gas with an energy return of 100 to 1. Hmm. For every barrel of oil we'd spend, we'd get 100 barrels back. But that's now down to 15 to 1.
Wow.
And it's part of the reason why energy is so expensive, particularly why petroleum is so expensive. Now we're moving into deeper and deeper offshore wells in the Gulf of Mexico, fracking in South Dakota, and these involve complex technologies that are very costly, and again, the energy return goes down on exploiting fossil fuels in this way. So in the future, it looks like the energy basis for being a complex society is going to grow more and more costly, and this is one of the major challenges that we face.
So what then? What happens if we, you know, if fossil fuels are no longer available in the abundance that we currently rely on, what are the possible ways that we proceed?
Well, people simply assume either that we're going to shift to nuclear power, although that now looks unlikely after the catastrophe in Japan a couple of years ago, or some form of renewable energy. The problem of renewable energy is that it has low energy density. In other words, if you're going to rely on either wind power or solar energy, you need a lot of land area to get the same energy per person that we get now from fossil fuels. There was a study done in England a few years ago looking at the question, how would you provide renewable energy for the people of England and Wales equivalent to the amount per capita that they have today? Well, it turned out the calculation showed that to do that would take all of the land area of England and Wales,
wow,
which is clearly not feasible. Now, in the United States, we're better endowed with large land areas, But even still, we're talking about major investments in infrastructure and the loss of a lot of lands that would come to be covered by industrial energy production systems. And this is a cost that we may someday have to accept. But one of the main problems with renewable energy is that the infrastructure is so vast that once it is in place, you have to ask how quickly could we increase energy production if we needed to, because that would require still more infrastructure. You know, in 1940, we could produce more oil and gas simply by opening valves, and this is how we fought World War II. In 1941, something like one-third of U.S. energy production capacity was not being used. So to fund World War II, to fight World War II, we simply opened valves. We were able to do that. In the future, if we want to increase energy production and we're reliant on renewable energy, we won't be able simply to open valves. It will take major investments in technology and infrastructure that will take a long time to build.
Okay.